Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot, and welcome to the first day of Squatchmas. Wow, it is hard to believe, but we are already to the middle of December. Thanks for taking time out of your busy holiday schedule to be with me this evening. I do hope you've got some good snackage lined up. The first stop is going to take us into Colorado, and what starts out as such a simple thing, well, in years, it became a Sasquatch-centric Christmas tradition. Are you ready? I knew you would be. Let's go. Hi, Nance. Here is my contribution to the 12 days of Squatchmas. I do hope you can use it. We lived on the outskirts of a town called Rye, Colorado. This is back in 2005. The houses in that area are spread apart, but there are trees between most of the houses. Mom and Dad's house had a long driveway, so to get to the road for the mail, it was a little bit of a walk. Most of the time it was fine, and I enjoyed the walk to the road and back to get the mail. But if it was raining or snowing or just awful cold weather, it could make for a miserable journey. We had a golf cart that had been my grandmother's when she lived in Florida. After she passed on, Mom and Dad brought the golf cart up to Colorado, and we used it all around our property. It was definitely nicer than your average golf cart. I loved to ride around in it. I remember one time I got grounded off of it because I got busted doing some donuts out back around the spruce trees. I was 14. I wiped out, and the golf cart ended up on its side and very badly scratched. Mostly, I did behave with it. I can't lie. I did have fun with it. It did okay on snow, too, if the drive had been plowed down or if the snow was already compacted from driving over it. But you couldn't use the golf cart to break through fresh snow. In my senior year of high school, I played soccer, and I ended up with a torn meniscus. I ended up having to have surgery, and for most of that winter, I did my schooling from home, before homeschooling was a thing. I was healing, and I was just getting around a bit with my crutches. One night, we had had snow, and the next day, my dad had plowed our driveway before he left for work. There wasn't a lot of snow out there, maybe only 6 inches overnight. Later that day, when the mail ran, I offered to take the golf cart on out and get the mail. I know it sounds silly, but just going from the house to the mailbox, well, I looked forward to it. It was nice to get out of the house. I was a teenager, remember. I wasn't used to being on lockdown. It had warmed up that day, and some of the snow was melting off. The driveway was all patches of snow and wet mud and gravel. It was very bright out by that time, and the snow that was still on the ground around me made it feel and look much brighter. It was the kind of snowy day that if I had had to drive somewhere, I would have needed my sunglasses, or I would have squinted the whole way. So I hobble out to the cart. I hop on one foot and leave my crutches on the steps. I can drive the golf cart right up to the mailbox and reach in without getting out of the cart, so there was no reason for me to take them. I putter on down the drive toward the road and the mailbox. The trees are all bare of leaves, and they're mixed with some pines, firs, and spruces throughout our property. I'm looking down through the trees because, unlike the rest of the year, I can see clear through halfway down the road to the next neighbor's house. And sometimes, when I look down there, I will see deer down there, even in the afternoon. For a long time, my mom liked to feed the deer, and she had had a running feud with the neighbor that used to live down there because he knew my mom was feeding deer, and he would often shoot them. One time, he shot a deer while it was standing in our yard. We only know it happened because we found the blood trail that led back to his house. But he was gone now, though. He went to prison on some other charge, and after him, some nice people bought that house, thankfully. But Mom had quit feeding her deer because of him. And it's like the deer have never forgotten that she fed them. They still came around, and they came into our yard a lot. That meant I like to watch them, and I got to all the time. That probably sounds silly to someone else, but it was one of my favorite things about living out there. So I'm winding down the last few feet of the drive to the mailbox, and I'm looking down each side through the trees. I slam on my brake pedal. I thought I saw a man about halfway between our house and the neighbor's house. It looked like a man, but also not like a man. It wasn't like anything I knew. It was very bright out, so I squinted, trying to see clearly. See, the thing is, I thought, maybe it was someone trying to poach deer again. That had been a problem in the past, too. There were these guys a couple roads over, and they knew there were deer all around our house. And they would come, and they would try to get one. The only problem is, there are people living right here. And rifles and arrows, they do not need to be used in residential settings. But those men did not care. They wanted that deer meat at all costs. So, if that was a guy down there, I needed to hightail it back to the house and call the authorities as well as get inside where I'm not going to accidentally take an arrow to the chest. I'm just starting to turn around, and I'm still trying to watch whoever it was. Then I slam on the brake again. I notice this is not a person. It's too big, tall, and wide. And they walked strange. I don't have words for it. They were also dressed or covered in something that was close to the color of the tree bark. It was a dull grayish brown. And then I realized, that's not clothing. That looks more like hair or fur. I was struck at the perfect camouflaging color of whatever it was next to the trees. If they had stopped, I probably would have had a hard time finding them standing next to any tree out there. It had climbed to the low 40s that day, and the snow was melting. With the sun out, no one would need to bulk up with that much of coats. I watched for another minute, and then all of a sudden, I had goose pimples all over me. I felt it under my sweatshirt hoodie, all up and down my arms. It was walking away from me at a diagonal between our place and the neighbor's. I watched it until it got out of sight completely. Its walk was fast, fluid, and other than that, I can only tell you that it was strange. I just don't have the words. The sun was shining brightly right on me, but I felt a shiver hit me. I quickly went out to the road, got the mail, and then turned around, and I just as quickly made it right down the driveway straight back to the house. But I kept an eye down the direction I had seen whoever or whatever it was. I got inside, and I told my mom what I had seen. She dismissed it. She said it was probably just somebody trespassing, and that happened as well. But she did call all the neighbors that we spoke to, and she told them to be aware. But no one had seen anything. I did not agree with my mom that it was just something normal like a person. I couldn't describe how or why, but it didn't fit to me that it was something normal. I knew it wasn't. The thought that it could be a Sasquatch did cross my mind later that night as I thought about it. The size of it, the color, the way it walked, all of it had me convinced that was not a guy out there. And having Sasquatch in Colorado, it was not unheard of. Well, that was it for a while. Then we heard some screams at night, and a few times we heard knocks on nearby trees. We always heard three knocks in a row, with about a second to a second and a half between each knock. We all said it was just kids out there playing around, but we did wonder why they were out there in the dark, because that's when we always heard the weird things happening. It would be right after sundown or very early in the morning when we were leaving. My senior year, I was on and off again with a boy that I'd been dating since ninth grade. I'll call him Jacob. We had really been together so long that we were outgrowing each other, but we didn't have the maturity to know it, to admit it, and to call it quits. Now, during one of our on times, he would often come by my house when he got off work from the grocery store. So oftentimes, between 9 and 10 o'clock at night, Jacob would stop by the house, And if we were having some difficult discussions, which were becoming more and more frequent, we would go sit in his car. Now, my parents' rule was we could go sit in the car for private talking, but we had to pull right up next to the front porch. The outside lights all needed to be on, and the front curtains were opened. My mom and dad could look out and see us that way. They could make sure we were just sitting there in the car, talking, and nothing else. So this night I'm leading up to, it was just before Christmas. I don't remember how many days before, but we had already decorated, and our front porch was lit up with those icicle lights all over it. The whole front of the house was outlined in white icicle lights. And between those, the snow, and a bright moonlit night, the visibility and clarity out there was very good. Just on the other side of being daylight kind of good visibility. We're sitting and we're talking in his car. He had turned the car on so we had some heat. There were a lot of uncomfortable moments when we weren't talking to each other, but just looking out the window. I started to say something to him, and Jacob cut me off. He said, "Oh my God, Cheryl, I think someone's going to rob us." I'm like, "What? What are you talking about?" Jacob lays on the car's horn. I kept trying to ask him what was wrong, what was going on. I don't know if he just was ignoring me or if he couldn't hear me for the car horn. In about 2 seconds flat, my dad comes tearing out of the front door. He wants to know what the heck is going on, only he didn't say heck. Jacob rolls down his window and he tells my dad, "There's some man creeping through the trees over there." Jacob thought that it was going to come for us in the car, this man or whoever. He said he was creeping and he thought it was weird, like he was going to rob us or maybe he was casing the house. My dad is looking at Jacob like he's lost his mind. After a moment, I stopped and I had to tell my dad that while I didn't see anything that night, I had to think about what I had told Mom, so I told Dad what I saw a few weeks before, which, until that very second, I don't think my dad knew about any of that happening. So, that's what happened that night, but only Jacob saw it. But a couple more days go by, and it kind of happens again. This time, my mom and dad had just come back from the grocery store. They had pulled up, and they were unloading groceries onto the front porch. I was still on crutches at that time, so I had stayed home. But I opened the door when I heard them pull up. They were pulling bags of groceries out and putting them on the porch. And that's when I heard my mom. She just said my dad's name. And then she tapped him on the arm and pointed over to a line of white pines that stood between our two properties. So naturally, I looked over that way, too. It's late afternoon, maybe 4 or 5 o'clock. It's winter, so it will be dark soon, and most of the area was already in shadows. But I could see what they were looking at. It was the being that I had seen a few weeks earlier. But now, it was closer and clearer. And where before, I might have been mistaken thinking it was a really big man all swaddled up in some kind of clothing. There's no way I could mistake that now. It was standing in a line of the sparse white pines that stood on the front edge of the trees between our property and our neighbors over in the general direction that I had seen this being only a few weeks prior. But this time, it was much closer, facing us and standing still. It seemed to be watching us. I don't know the distance that it stood, but I could not see its face in detail. But beyond that, I did have the impression it was somehow looking directly at us. Later, my mom said that she could see its face clearly, but I don't know how she could do that. But she said the face was expressionless, and it was just looking at us. This lasted about 2 seconds. We all stood there looking at it, and it was looking at us. The shape and size was bigger than I had thought from before. The thing I noticed now was the head looked like someone had pushed it down onto its shoulders, and it had no neck. when I saw that, and I saw the domed head, I saw the big shoulders, I saw everything. That's when I knew we had a Sasquatch on the property. Dad told us girls to go on in and he'd get the groceries. I remember being a little in awe and a little worried because my dad, he didn't seem worried by it at all. But watching him, I saw that he was keeping an eye on it the whole time, because no matter which way he turned as he got groceries out of the car, he kept turning his head right to where it was. When my dad was done, I said to him, "That was a Sasquatch, wasn't it?" He said, "No, Cheryl, I don't think so. Probably just somebody pranking us." I thought, well, you know, he didn't act like that's what he thought it was when we were outside. But I didn't say that to him. "You didn't push my dad, trust me." The last thing I said to him that day was that we should probably call someone to have it investigated. Dad did not agree. He said no reason to investigate someone pulling a prank. No harm done. I said, okay, fine. So now it has been sighted 3 times in a month. Me, Jacob, and now my mom and dad. Now the last 2 times happened roughly within the same week, as I recall. But I saw this thing again on the morning of Christmas Eve. I was sitting in our breakfast area, which is right by the sliding glass doors that look out that side of the house toward the neighbors where it had been seen. I was sitting there eating grape nut cereal, and I saw it by the stacked wood. I couldn't stop watching it. It had a stick, and it was poking around in the stacked wood. I have no idea what it was doing. I sat there and did not move a muscle. I don't think it knew I was there, and I did not want to scare it off. This was the closest it had been, and it was the best chance I had to observe it. It was clearly after something, but I never did see what that something was. This went on for maybe a minute or two. Then it stood straight up. It looked up into the sky and all around. I don't know what it was looking at, if anything. Then it looked down at the stick in its hand, waved it once or twice like it didn't know what to do with it. Then it dropped it on the ground. Then it began to walk back to the north part of the tree line of our property. I watched it till it disappeared from sight in the trees. When Jacob called me from work on his break that afternoon from the grocery store, I asked him if he was coming over that night, and he said yes. I said, "Would you bring me a bag, one of those bags of mixed fruit, you know, the kind with all the different colored apples and some oranges and tangerines in it?" He said, "Sure, whatever you'd like." So that evening, with Jacob's help, I went out there in the tree line, and I spread that fruit all around. I put it where I knew my parents wouldn't see it. I told Jacob that it was for the deer, like a Christmas treat for them. He looked at me like I was crazy. Now, no one, not my parents, nor any of the neighbors, and certainly not Jacob, no one thought there was anything of interest out there. But I was convinced we had a Sasquatch on the property. I don't know if the Sasquatch got that fruit or not, but when I went out there the day after Christmas, which was the first chance I could make a break out of the house without being questioned, all of the apples and the oranges, all of it, was gone. Every single piece of fruit. There was no evidence that an animal had came and ate them or left any debris behind. Every piece of fruit was gone. There were a few more things over that winter that made me wonder, is that the Sasquatch out there? And by then, I had actually begun to think of it as my Sasquatch. I was feeding it, after all. You know, I still think about my Sasquatch every Christmas Eve. And the very first year that my kids were old enough to understand it, I told them this story, and I told it as we drove to their grandparents' house in Colorado. I love telling them this story every year, and it's a tradition now. They always ask about Mom's Sasquatch and Christmas Eve. We always go get a bag of apples or other fruits, and we go out in the tree line at Grandma and Grandpa's, and we leave the fruit. We do it whether we go to Colorado for Christmas, and we do it when we stay at home in Northern California, where we now live. Sometimes I will go and I will check, and I can see that some animals have eaten the fruit. They leave evidence and debris and half-gnawed pieces here and there. But there was another time, just a few years ago, right back at home in Colorado. I had left a 5-pound bag of mixed fruit out on the back porch at my parents' house. I was intending to go out and put it in the tree line, as I always did. But one of the kids called me in, and I got distracted when I got inside. I had just set it on the porch and walked in to help the kids. Next thing I know, it's Christmas morning. I had forgotten all about that bag of fruit. In a panic, I go to the back porch to look for it. The bag of fruit was gone. I would like to think that the Sasquatch still looks for that friendly girl who leaves fruit out for him, and he knows when I'm there. But I have never seen him again, and only once has the fruit disappeared again, the day a whole 5-pound bag of apples went missing. Now somehow, Christmas and Sasquatch are tightly interwoven now, not just for me, but also for my children. They're starting to get older now, but every year they still ask to be told the Christmas story about the Christmas Eve Sasquatch and how their mother fed him. Me, I enjoy telling it. Thanks, I appreciate you letting me share in Squatchmas. Cheryl Jimerson from Redding, California. Well, I don't know about you all, but I'm pretty envious of Cheryl. What a Christmas tradition. And as much as I would like to say we can all go out and feed the Sasquatches, that's not really practical for most of us, is it? I think we would be better off if we all found something at a local animal shelter that they need. I don't know how your shelter works, but Animal Friends Humane Society here in Butler County always has a standing list of things they're always in need of. Things like kitten milk formula, puppy chow, even things like a roll of stamps to help them do some mailings. So, while we can't get out, and or at least most of us can't get out and feed a Sasquatch this season, you know, you can always check what your animal shelter needs. I'm pretty sure Sasquatch would approve. All right, everyone. Well, that's it for the first night of Squatchmas. Thanks for hanging out with me. Now, you know, we'll be getting together again tomorrow and the day after that and the day after that, all the way to Christmas Eve. But until we do meet up again tomorrow, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.